Hello, welcome to the Checkpoint this week with me, Vivian Kamsimi. Now, the Uganda People's Congress defeated National Resistance Movement in the just concluded Oyam North by-election. Does this mean that the UPC is back on its feet and is ready to take up the leadership of this country? My guest is Honorable James Jimmy Akena, the president of UPC, also the Member of Parliament for Lira City, and a son of our founding father, Dr. Milton Obote. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for hosting me.
Mm-hmm. Congratulations upon this win in Oyam. How is it so far?
So far, it was a short but hectic campaign. So we're just trying to wind down, waiting for the swearing in, and then proceeding with the politics.
We saw you in that bitter exchange with the NRM Electoral Commission chairperson, Dr. Tango Doi. What was that? What happened?
During the campaign, the UPC candidate was very well received. And it was clear in the rallies, the level of support was extremely high. But the concerns that voters kept on raising is that if we vote, will you be able to protect our vote? Which I gave assurance that we will, and that we'll be there until the final vote is counted. And my assessment during the campaign is that we had a winning candidate and the ground was ours. But there seemed to be indications that, and some NRM leaders made it clear that hook or crook, we're taking the seat. So we were warning that don't rig. We want a fair and fair election. Whatever the voters decide is what we're going to respect. So it had been boiling up. And then the events which took place leading up to that election day. For example, Electoral Commission had brought in vehicles from across the country to transport the ballot box from their stores to the polling stations. And they had informed us, they opened their stores at 4 in the morning, we're free to witness, and we're free to escort the ballot, voting material, from the EC stores to the polling station. Now, since Oyam North has 46 parishes, I had deployed 50 motorcycles to follow up and to make sure that when the voting material arrives at the polling station, these riders of ours are supposed to report back whether our agents were there. The night leading to elections, those motorcycles were picked up by police. I spent part of the night trying to get them released, and we're getting all sorts of conditions, including we should show proof of ownership. Now, in the middle of the night, how you can show proof of ownership is something which is extremely difficult. It will take a bit of time. So there was a gap. And that gap, to me, looked like police were aiding the issue of rigging, because one of the most vulnerable points is at the opening of the polling station. That is often where stuffing takes place. So we went through that one, spent half the night trying to get the motorcycles released. Also, some of our polling agents were accosted at night. So it was difficult. So by the time that scene of myself with Tango Doi happened, there's a build-up. And then there was actual stuffing in a very crude and callous manner. So that is the background of where I seem to have lost a bit of my composure as far as the rigging was concerned. And it didn't only happen in that polling station, it happened in two others in a short space of time. And the other two happened when a commissioner of the Electoral Commission was present. And since we agreed on a formula of starting the voting afresh, the same was done in the other two polling stations.
It really sounds like, for you, this was a win that really took you so much to actually get. And we saw that you won by about 557 votes. That is, yes, significant, because, I mean, it's still a win. But what explains this win? Is it the strength of UPC? Is it that the candidate you fielded was strong in that area? Is it the that candidate is popular in Oyam? But also, could it be that the NRM is weaker in Lango?
The NRM's choice of fielding the son of the late has been a winning formula in many by-elections. And therefore, that's what I think the reason why they picked that candidate, and that was the main thrust of their campaign. Now, though we caught the stuffing in three polling stations, it doesn't mean it didn't happen in others, which we're not able to catch, because there are some places where we were put on a back foot, as I explained, assaulting of some of our polling agents, and some of the gaps which we had in monitoring that one. So that gap could have been larger, but I also believe that, yes, we had a strong candidate. But all of these things have to come together. You have to have the right candidate, you also have to have the right message, and this is a delicate one where you have to campaign against the son of a person who has died in a very tragic manner, and just a short while ago. I mean, memories will be so fresh. It's not something which has happened over a long period of time. So it was the sympathy votes will be there. Mm. Now, how do you overcome something like that without being insensitive, callous? So it was a difficult line to weave, but I believe that we had the right candidate for it, and also the team which we assembled to be able to campaign consisted of leaders of UPC, from largely from the sub-region, who, I would say, were handpicked, because you couldn't just have anybody on the microphone. You can create a problem, or if anybody made any slight gaffe on the microphone, you don't have time to correct it. You know, 13 days campaign, any mistakes, you'll have a difficult time running it back. So I thank the team who were on board. I thank the candidate with her strengths and which she brought on there, and also the voters who came out and were quite determined.
It was an intense period, I can imagine. But what does this win mean for you? Are you back to competing for leadership of this country?
Definitely. It has energized the party, and the party is quite ready to take up a more positive role. And we're going to be moving ahead to keep the momentum, because 2026 is not too far down the road. And I'm quite certain that the party will want to field a candidate for president as well in this coming round.
Some analysts think that you have defeated this hereditary politics that we've been seeing in other areas, like you said. And you also know that you're actually a beneficiary of some of this hereditary politics. What do you think about it?
I mean, from the Bible, it says a good name is worth more than silver and gold. If you have a good name in whatever field, whether journalism, whether in politics or whatever, but you still have to do the work. It might be able to get you through the door, but once you're in the door, you will have to maintain. I don't believe that this will be the end of it, but in this particular case, we were able to find a way of prevailing, which is not quite normal in most cases. Most previous cases, the relative of the deceased have gone through. And so maybe this is one case where it didn't happen as such, but I don't rule out that it may not happen again in future.
Dr. Yunis Apio becomes the 10th Member of Parliament for UPC. Mm-hmm. And this still keeps you as one of the minority parties in Parliament. What kind of difference does this win bring or make to your party? At the national stage where you have to play as a unit in Parliament?
This win is very significant in that it shows the possibilities which are there. Yes, it was a by-election, but you are competing against the ruling government, which deployed a lot of resources. A lot of human resource and a lot of material resource was involved in this. We had several RDCs, we had several DPCs, we had MPs, ministers across the board trying to support the NRM candidate. So a by-election puts more in focus, and it also creates an environment which is a little harder than in most cases in a general election. But the fact that we've been able to prevail, it has really energized a lot of the UPC members, and we're going to use it as a stepping stone to prepare for the next round of elections.
You just talked about the ruling party, the National Resistance Movement. Your party has had a cordial relationship with them, and you have had an agreement where you're working together. In fact, we know that your wife, who is also a member of the UPC, Honorable Betty Amongi, the Minister of Gender. We also know about history here, and that is the fact that your founding father, chairman, former chairman of your party.
President. Chairman is a smaller position in
UPC. Your president, okay. The president of your party was a very big enemy to the NRM chairperson right now, the president, President Yoweri Kaguta Museveni. In fact, your father's number one enemy. And at one point, he called him a Satan. How do you think he would feel about this relationship?
I think in many cases, people have misconstrued the sort of base of the relationship. For example, NRM have always fielded a candidate against me. I've contested against an NRM candidate. You mentioned Honorable Betty Amongi. Equally, NRM have fielded a candidate against her. So it's not unusual that we'll have candidates. We're going to be in competition. So I don't expect it any different at whichever constituency. I mean, there are people who've been saying that it was maybe a bit of friendly, but my approach on trying to engage the NRM, it is to try to bring down the tempo. As you mentioned, in those days before multipartism came in, there was a lot of war of words. As we're coming to multipartism, we had to engage in a different way. And if we're able to have a cordial or a semi-cordial conversation on political matters, I think it would be helpful in moving the politics forward. And that's the approach which I've been using. And in some areas, we've been able to get some level of success. For example, under the iPod arrangement, we've been able to hold some serious conversations on matters of concern. So my approach is, yes, we can engage across the board, but that does not affect the identity and the ideology of UPC. That remains. And should UPC be in government, we're going to govern in a completely different way to NRM. NRM, because of the results of the last elections, will be implementing their manifesto. That's what's on the table. 2026, anything can happen.
You know, talking about your wife serving this government, Honorable Betty Amongi, she's of course the Minister of Gender, like I just said. We saw her being absent in this by-election. We did not see her campaigning for your candidate, and yet she's one of the key leaders in that region, in Lango sub-region. In fact, in Oyam, she could have made impact for you, but then she avoided it, and we have seen posters of her in yellow. What does that mean?
No. It was by decision. I was leading the campaign, and I thought it would be very insensitive and send the wrong picture if Honorable Betty, who was the senior minister in that ministry, because the late Macho Dogo was the Minister of State for Labor and Industrial Relations under the same Minister of Gender. And therefore, in the whole funeral process, Honorable Betty was coordinating the side of government. We also have a woman member of parliament for the same district of Oyam, who was coordinating matters within parliament. So it was my decision that the two of them should not be in the forefront. It would be very insensitive to have put them in the forefront, but I believe that we had sufficient members and leaders who could handle the campaign, and I think I was proved right. But I didn't think it was appropriate for them to be in the forefront in such a situation, coming from a tragedy like that.
Okay. I think that was a good thing on your part, because like you said, it is a sensitive thing. And the late having been under her ministry, then it would have been a different thing. But we have also seen posters of Honorable Betty Amongi in yellow, and she is going to be among the contestants for an NRM position, a big position, because this is the vice chairperson of Northern Region. That position was occupied by the late Honorable, Right Honorable Jacob Olanya. And now it is being rumored that she is going to be vying for that position. First of all, are these rumors right?
The picture which has been circulating on social media was a picture where she was addressing a press conference during the NSSF issue. Often when you're putting a poster for elective position, you really look for the right poster. You don't just pick any picture off the internet and do some photo editing and whatever. People take time in developing posters. So somebody who picked this poster or this picture, it's a picture which you'll find on the internet. If you Google Betty NSSF, it's one of the pictures which will come up. So definitely that was not a creation of Honorable Betty. And therefore, the conclusions and assumptions around it do not come in, because it's not something which has been put out in that particular issue. I know that there's a lot of interest in that position, and of course there are people who have approached various people that how is this position going to be filled. So that is not something which falls within the scope of what is going on, because at this stage it is more a question of speculation. And of course those who may have interest are trying to build it up, because in the campaign people, at least some of the NRM NRM campaigners were saying that when the president comes, Honorable Betty is going to cross, amongst others. So it is not something which I took it more as campaign issues.
So you're telling us that the Honorable Betty Among will not be defecting from UPC to the NRM?
And not now.
Okay. This alliance with the NRM, how has it been working between the UPC and the National Resistance Movement? As UPC, do you feel that you have achieved the reasons as to why you actually had this agreement? Or is this way that you handled the Oyam by-election a way to say, no, we are taking back our matters into our own control, and we are going to be coming up to different seats and contest for leadership in this country?
I think it cuts both ways. There have been some aspects where it might have added something, and there's some aspects where it has been misunderstood and has been exploited negatively. Mm. I honestly believe that if I'd taken a very strong antagonistic position, possibly myself and many of the leaders who are in Oyam would have been possibly arrested or manhandled very seriously. The fact that we've been able to have some cordial understandings, it was possibly not as easy for us to be manhandled. But at the same time, there are those even within the party who were very uncomfortable. But from the point where it started, where positions were offered in government, and this is something which I must stress, that there will always be a government of Uganda. at this stage, it is being headed by NRM, but that's not going to always be the case. And so we must draw a distinction between serving in government and serving in the NRM. So we discussed it and agreed for some of our members to serve in government. So we may need to review it at some stage, but coming off the back of OYAM, I think UPC is really intent on showing more of its independence and fielding its own candidates across board for every position.
Honorable James Jimmy Akena, we are going to be taking a very short break and we will be back with Honorable James Jimmy Akena and me, Vivian Kamsime, talking about the UPC, the OYAM North by-election. And then, is the UPC ready to take back the leadership of this country?